Good afternoon and welcome to members both of the Yale and New Haven communities who show by your very presence your appreciation of the critical nature of the issues of climate for each of us, for every community, and for the welfare of our planet. My name is Linda Koch-Lorimer. I am Vice President for Global and Strategic Affairs, and one of the strategic initiatives during the service of both Yale President Richard Levin and now Peter Salovey has been to make attention to sustainability a part of this institution's daily life. Of course, the central work of the university on sustainability, like everything else, is propelled by the research and educational enterprises of our schools, faculty, and students. None more so than climate issues, where there is a phalanx of academic programs and policy centers over several schools at Yale tackling important aspects of these issues. But Yale, as an organization with almost 20,000 people and a big footprint in this city, needs to do its own part. That is why we made ambitious targets for reducing Yale's carbon footprint, increasing recycling, addressing our building practices from landscaping to stormwater management. That is why President Salovey announced last month 6 new initiatives, including increasing our solar arrays and studying the possibility that perhaps we here may be able to introduce a carbon fee scheme within the university that might be pathbreaking and a model for others. In short, the subject that brings us all together is one that requires the participation of us all in ways big and small, as individuals, entities, and institutions. Our guest is one who is doing the most and on the largest stage to advance climate policy. That is why it's a special privilege to welcome U.S. Special Envoy for Climate Change, Todd Stern, here to this joint program sponsored by both the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies and the Yale Law School. We're particularly grateful to Dean Robert Post of the Law School for making this wonderful venue available. Mr. Stern has led the United States in global talks since 2009 and comes here today only a few weeks after being at the United Nations Climate Summit, where, as we've all have read, there were more than 100 leaders, heads of state, business leaders, NGOs, civil society leaders coming together calling for a much more ambitious action on climate change. After Mr. Stern's remarks, there will be time for some of the questions that have been collected over the last week through a New Age online question box at the Farsi School's website. We thank all of you, both here and throughout the internet world, who have submitted questions through this process. Now, for a proper introduction, let me turn to Professor Matt Cochin from the School of Forestry and Environmental Studies, who was recently serving as the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Environment and Energy at the U.S. Treasury Department, and there a colleague with Mr. Stern. Thank you.
Thanks, Linda. Thanks to everybody for turning out. It is personally a great pleasure to welcome Todd Stern to Yale. As Linda mentioned, Todd serves as the Special Envoy for Climate Change at the U.S. State Department. And cutting through the terminology of Washington, D.C., this means that Todd is one of the highest-ranking U.S. officials focused primarily on climate change in the U.S. government. In this role, Todd is President Obama's chief climate negotiator, representing the United States internationally in all bilateral and multilateral negotiations regarding climate change. Todd also participates in the development of domestic climate and energy policies. We are in a law school, and there is no reasonable doubting that these are important times for climate change. As the scientific evidence continues to build, our understanding of the challenges posed by climate change become ever more complex and significant. While countries around the world have taken actions domestically to different degrees, we have a long way to go. And ultimately, climate change is a global problem, one that will require some level of international coordination to solve. On this front, we truly are at a critical time. At the United Nations Climate Summit a few weeks ago in New York City, world leaders, in addition to hundreds of thousands of activists, gathered to begin building momentum for a new international climate agreement. Now coming up in December, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change will hold its annual meeting in Lima, Peru, to begin paving the way for another meeting in Paris in 2015, where and when the intent is to forge a new international climate change agreement. Todd Stern leads the United States in this effort and is therefore a critical element in this process. And we, those of us in the United States, and also those in other countries, are fortunate to have Todd in that position. This I know firsthand. As Linda mentioned, I recently was on leave from Yale working in the US Treasury Department on climate change issues. And there I worked closely with Todd and his team on several areas where the State Department and the Treasury Department have a close working relationship. I learned a few things about Todd during that time, and these are characteristics that are widely recognized about him in the US government. Todd cares deeply about climate change as an issue. Todd is skilled at navigating the political process, both domestically and internationally, having also served in a range of previous positions, including some in the White House and also Treasury. And Todd is truly unique in his concern for understanding the details of climate change as a complex problem, requiring new types of solutions. As evidence of this characteristic, Todd has just spent the day today with our faculty and students to hear about their concerns and their research insights. Few in Todd's position would set aside this amount of time to listen, but Todd clearly wants to know some of the insights from leading thinkers and what they have to say. And as it turns out, many of us here at Yale are happy to tell others what we think. But now it's our time to listen, and Todd will deliver his remarks, after which we will have an opportunity to hear him respond to some of the questions that many of you have proposed. But first, and without any further introduction, please join me in welcoming Todd Stern.
Thank you very much. I don't usually get a double-barreled introduction, so that was much appreciated. It is a real pleasure and privilege for me to be here at Yale. I have always had great fondness and admiration for this place. I want to thank Matt for doing so much to put this day together. I want to thank my old friend Harold Coe, the remarkable legal advisor for Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, who I first met back in 1991, I think it was, when I recruited Harold to speak at a war powers hearing that I was setting up for my then boss, Patrick Leahy. I also want to thank Linda Lorimer, and Peter Crane, and Robert Post, and everybody else who put on a terrific day for me here at Yale. So thank you so much. I guess maybe I'm going to thank one more son of Yale, which is my boss, Secretary of State John Kerry, whose leadership and passion for this issue is visible every day. And I also want to recognize up front Yale's broad commitment to dealing with climate change and to your rich endowment of thinkers on this subject across a wide range of disciplines. As Matt said, I had a chance to visit with a number of people today, which was very interesting and informative. But across natural science and economics, law, policy, and so forth. And it's an enormously impressive group of people, and we learn from you. Today we are poised for our stretch run regarding the latest round of international negotiations, which were launched at the end of 2011 in Durban and are scheduled to culminate in Paris in 2014. In just over 6 weeks, this year's negotiating session begins in Lima, and will play an important role in setting the table for what then happens in Paris. Climate negotiations have been going on in one way or another for over 20 years now, and they are always fraught with peril, but we have a real opportunity now to do something significant. The main focus of my remarks today will be on this Durban round of the negotiations, what we need to do and what we need to avoid in order to get a successful agreement. Before we get there, I want to briefly review some of the important developments of the last year, because there have been a lot of developments with respect to science, policy, technology, and political engagement. And it's always worth remembering, particularly for those of us who work on the international side, that international negotiations, while crucial, are by no means the whole answer. The international side is necessary, but definitely not sufficient. The essential task before us, after all, is to transform the energy base of our economies from high to low carbon. And this depends on the political will of governments at home, setting the rules of the road, providing the incentives, removing the barriers, funding the R&D, and spurring the investment needed to hasten this transformation. On the critical issues of political will and public support, I think we are moving toward a tipping point. We're not there yet. I can't say exactly when we're going to get there, but it's coming, I think. And we have all seen in recent years the abruptness with which previously hot-button issues can suddenly become the stuff of consensus. You see more and more signs out there, investors expressing concerns about the potential for stranded assets in the fossil fuel industry. You see major industrial companies modeling the effects of future carbon pricing on their bottom line. You see a move in public opinion polls, captured, for example, in the spring report on politics and global warming by the Yale Project on Climate Change Communications. You see some change of tone, even from those who have been aggressive climate change deniers, not to embracers, but to a little bit less of the stridency that they'd shown before. I doubt, actually, that even a year from now, whether major political candidates will consider it a viable strategy to deny the existence of climate change. So I think something is definitely happening out there. I think the pace at which it is happening is going to quicken, and especially driven by young people like those here at Yale who have the most to lose by dawdling evasion. On our own home front, President Obama has mobilized a full throttle effort to combat climate change. He took important action on climate in his first term, including the issuance of major new rules to double the fuel efficiency of vehicles and new rules with respect to medium and heavy duty vehicles as well. But from the moment of his second inaugural address, the president really signaled that climate change had become a first order priority. In his State of Union address just a few weeks later, he left no doubt that he was ready to take bold action. And then several months after that, he gave a memorable speech on climate change at Georgetown, where he announced his climate action plan. And ever since, the White House and the Cabinet have been in high gear to implement the plan, driving action to reduce emissions, build greater resilience, and increase public awareness. In a steady drumbeat of second-term actions and events, the administration has, to give just a few examples, issued a landmark proposed rule that will cut emissions in the power sector by 30% by 2030, issued another proposed rule imposing strict standards, rigorous standards on new power plants, moved at a rapid pace to issue tough efficiency standards for the equipment and appliances that make buildings run, announced the planned extension of heavy-duty vehicle standards beyond 2018, announced a broad strategy to reduce the emissions of methane, our second most important greenhouse gas, another important rule regarding HFCs, an industrial gas with highly, very intense global warming potential, and issue the National Climate Assessment on Climate Impacts here at home, showing that climate change is affecting every sector of the economy and every region of the country. And we are talking more about climate change. The president is, the cabinet is, very much including my own boss, Secretary Kerry, and other administration leaders as well. This mobilization of American effort matters enormously. It matters because the United States is the biggest economy and the largest historic emitter of greenhouse gases. And because here, as in so many areas, we feel a responsibility to lead, and because here, as in so many areas, American commitment is indispensable to effective international action. And make no mistake, other countries notice. They see what we're doing, and they take note. As I travel around the world and meet with my counterparts, the palpable engagement of President Obama and his team has put us in a stronger and more credible position than ever before. Meanwhile, in New York last month, during the UN Climate Summit, where world leaders were supposed to be the main event, the people stole the show, marching in the streets, 400,000 of them, in the biggest climate demonstration in US history. And the climate summit itself saw strong expressions of commitment by a wide array of world leaders, including President Obama, and the announcement of a broad array of new initiatives by countries, regions, cities, businesses, NGOs. On still another front, the non-political story gathering force is clean energy development and dissemination. Some of this involves technological discovery, some involves dissemination, and some indicates a shift in the zeitgeist toward clean energy. And the fact that these developments occur despite mixed signals and incentives from government suggests that a clean tech revolution could occur if we just get those signals right. Consider simply a few examples. From 2010 to 2013, over 30% of new electricity generation capacity in the United States involved solar and wind, and costs are falling dramatically. Down 50% in the US for wind in the last 5 years, down about half for utility scale photovoltaics in the last 3 years, and on track to drop another half by 2020 toward our goal of 6 cents per kilowatt hour. And what this means is solar and wind are knocking on the door of cost parity with fossil fuels. Remember, the holy grail is for non-fossil energy to become a better business proposition all in than fossil fuels. The game changer for large-scale reliance on intermittent renewables like wind and solar, because people need energy whether the wind is blowing or not, or whether the sun is shining or not, the game changer here is storage, and researchers are pursuing a wide variety of promising technologies from batteries to chemical storage, flywheels, and a lot more. Researchers at the Pacific Northwest National Lab are now injecting solar energy into natural gas to create a new synthetic gas, which will be able to cut the energy demand at natural gas plants by 20%, which would be a huge development. Researchers in bioenergy are making progress at a remarkable rate. The Department of Energy now believes that the price of so-called drop-in algae-based fuel, biofuels, could get down to a competitive level of $3 per gallon by 2017. Last year, Elon Musk, the founder and CEO of Tesla and chairman of SolarCity, was named Business Person of the Year by Fortune and Man of the Year by Forbes. Tesla sold around 21,000 cars last year, which is less than 1% of what Ford sold, but the market cap for Tesla is more than half of Ford's, about $30 billion. So investors are betting that Tesla has a big disruptive future ahead of itself, and so is Musk. He's building a $5 billion lithium-ion battery factory in Nevada, the largest battery factory in the world, capable of supplying 500,000 electric cars a year. Companies like SolarCity are outfitting tens of thousands of homes with PV systems thanks to a new business model in which they install and maintain the systems with no upfront charge at all and sell the power to homeowners at prices well below standard utility rates. The cover of the April Harvard Business Review is called Resilient Company: How to Thrive in a Warmer World, and includes a four-article spread inside. And the cover of the current Harvard magazine, I'm sorry for all of these Harvard references, I'm just trying to make a point here, but the cover of the current Harvard magazine is taxing carbon and boosting the economy. Developments around the world are also striking. Germany now gets 27% of its electricity from non-hydro renewable energy. Denmark gets over 40%. In 2013, China installed 12,000 megawatts of new solar power, 50% more than the world record, and more than all the years put together that China had done in the past. In India, where more than 300 million people lack access to electricity, the new Prime Minister Modi intends to produce enough solar electricity to power a light bulb in every one of those homes by 2019. The past year has also seen the publication of a raft of influential reports on climate science, climate impacts, and the economics of climate change. The IPCC, a broad panel of world-leading climate scientists, published the first three installments of its so-called fifth assessment report, the first one that it's done since 2007 when it won the Nobel Peace Prize. These reports describe unequivocal warming of the climate system and widespread and consequential impacts of climate change that are very likely to get worse. As already noted, the United States released our own national climate assessment regarding regional impacts such as increased heat waves and coastal flooding here in the Northeast, and increased droughts and wildfires in the Southwest. A nonpartisan alliance of three leaders in business and politics, former Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson, Former New York Mayor Mike Bloomberg and former hedge fund manager turned political activist Tom Steyer released a report called Risky Business, focusing on the steep cost of companies failing to take action on climate change. And just last month, an international coalition led by former Mexican President Felipe Calderon released the New Climate Economy, an important report on achieving economic growth while fighting climate change. The report doesn't sugarcoat the challenge of the clean energy transformation, but says it is achievable at a relatively modest cost that will be paid off over time if we get the policy right. The report says the next 15 years are critical because some $90 trillion will be invested in long-lasting infrastructure in energy, land use, and cities around the world, and we've got to invest it right in low-carbon alternatives. Now, hearing about this, all of these things going on outside of the world of the negotiations, you might wonder whether we need those fraught negotiations at all. And indeed, this is a subject in the room for debate section of the online New York Times. So there are people who actually are discussing that. But establishing a strong, sound, stable international regime is in fact a crucial part of the puzzle. We need an international agreement to prod countries to take aggressive action at home. We need it to supply the essential confidence that that countries require to know that if they act, their partners and their counterparts will act as well. We need it to send a clear signal to businesses, investors, innovators, and governments that the world's leaders have committed themselves and their nations to the climate fight. What I'm going to do now is to give you a bit of context about the international negotiations and then sketch out the kind of agreement we are trying to achieve, address the most important sticking points to getting this done, and finally share with you some thoughts about the approach that I think countries need to take in order to reach a consensus agreement. So first, some context. Climate change negotiations are inherently difficult for a number of reasons. First, because climate is by no means just an environmental problem. It is a problem that affects every aspect of national economies. And so it inherently makes countries nervous about action. They're also difficult because the UN body where these talks occur, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, includes over 190 nations. These nations are often grouped into various blocks with crisscrossing agendas. There are long-standing North-South resentments that continue to roil the debate. And negotiations are governed by a consensus rule of procedure, which in effect enables any small group of countries to block action. So this is not easy. Climate negotiations have been going on in one form or another for over 20 years. The foundational agreement was the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, concluded in 1992, and at that time approved in the Senate without controversy during the latter days of the Bush administration. The stated purpose of the convention is to avoid dangerous climate change. It created two main categories of countries based mostly on their material state of development: Annex I, largely the developed countries, and non-Annex I, the developing countries. We will return to this point later because this split between developed and developing countries and the Climate Convention is the singular fault line in these negotiations and has been from the beginning. The convention required all countries to take action to limit their greenhouse gas emissions, but didn't impose any specific obligations. In 1997, the parties negotiated the Kyoto Protocol, which did include individual, specific, legally binding commitments to reduce emissions in the period 2008 to 12, but exempted developing countries from such obligations. As it turned out, this exemption amounted to the political death knell for the Kyoto Protocol in the United States. The Clinton administration recognized political reality and stated that it would not submit the new agreement to the Senate for approval without, quote, meaningful participation from developing countries, and virtually none ever came. In 2001, the second President Bush effectively withdrew the United States from the ongoing Kyoto negotiations, and with the U.S. and developing countries on the sidelines, Kyoto never actually covered more than something in the order of 27% of U.S. emissions. In the two large annual climate conferences held in 2009 and 10, first in Copenhagen and then in Cancun, the parties negotiated new accords that were intended to cover the period through 2020. Copenhagen was a rancorous meeting and widely dismissed as a failure since it didn't deliver the comprehensive, legally binding treaty that many had dreamed of. But Copenhagen, together with Cancun, actually produced important results. For the first time, all major economies, developed and developing, and many others, agreed to implement mitigation targets or actions, and to do so under a new regime of international transparency. And though politically binding rather than legally binding, countries are working hard to meet those targets. Anybody who doubts that should just look at, first of all, what we're doing, because the action by President Obama and his administration is powerfully motivated by the effort to reach the 17% target that we submitted for Copenhagen, or look at China, which is or any number of other countries. China is also working very hard to meet the targets it put forward. Those accords also called for the establishment of a new green climate fund and a new technology center and network intended to provide technology assistance to poor countries. At the 2011 meeting in Durban, the parties launched a new round of negotiations meant to be concluded in 2015 and to cover the period from 2020 forward. That's the round that we're in now, the Durban round. The short mandate for this negotiation, known as the Durban Platform, stipulated in effect that the parties would seek to develop a new legal agreement that would be applicable to all with the precise legal nature to be determined later. The central meaning of this mandate was that the new agreement would not be Kyoto. The new agreement would have obligations and expectations that would apply to all countries. With developing countries already accounting for a majority of global emissions and on track to account for some two-thirds by 2030, there really is no other way to conceive of an international regime. So that's the context. Let me now sketch out the kind of agreement the United States is trying to achieve, an agreement that is ambitious so that it can start to put us on the track that science counsels. Inclusive, because we cannot meet our objectives without broad participation. Durable, because our mission now is to negotiate an agreement for the decades, not just for 5 or 10 years. And fair, so that countries feel their needs are respected and that they're getting a fair shake. We'll look at the three main pillars of climate agreements: mitigation, adaptation, and financial assistance. Mitigation is about reducing greenhouse gas emissions. It's what people think of when they think of action to contain climate change. Strong and progressively more robust action by countries to cut their emissions is surely the sine qua non of any climate agreement. The question for a new climate agreement is how to structure mitigation commitments to produce the most effective result. We support an agreement based on each country putting forward its own nationally determined commitment. Contribution in the lingo of these negotiations, and so it's a nationally determined commitment or contribution, depending on which word you use, or an NDC, also, so you get the lingo. This NDC structure, which has attracted a fair amount of convergence, makes sense. First, it will attract broad participation because it will quiet developing country fears of getting strong-armed into taking targets beyond their capability. And without broad participation, there will be no ambition. Second, it will produce undertakings that countries are generally prepared to implement. We think the first end date for NDCs ought to be 2025 because we think it will lead to greater ambition down the road than a later date such as 2030. In particular, both because we see political will and technology development increasing over time, we think the target we could put forward for 2030, 5 years from now, will be significantly more ambitious than a 2030 target we could put forward right now. But this is an open question, and there are some countries who prefer 2030, so this is a matter of continuing discussion. Beyond the first end date, we see a progressive updating of our targets every 5 years. Remember, the Paris Agreement is not just about 2025 or even just about 2030. It's about trying to create a lasting framework that won't have to be renegotiated over and over. We also propose that countries put their intended NDCs forward early, say 6 to 9 months before Paris, to allow for what we've called the consultative period as a means of encouraging the greatest possible ambition. This is really just a sunshine idea, and it has largely been accepted. Our reasoning was that if countries know their intended NDCs are going to be open for all to see, are going to be scrutinized and commented on by civil society, by other countries, by think tanks and analysts and the press, that this will goad them into putting their best foot forward. And I think that, in fact, will happen. We also support a strong accountability system. Whatever our mitigation commitments are in terms of content and legal character, and we'll come back to that legal question later, it is essential that others are able to understand clearly what those commitments are and to track whether they are being implemented. Such a system is made up, I think, of a number of elements. First, the undertaking itself needs to be clear. This may seem self-evident, but if you look at the submissions made after Copenhagen, you'll see that it's actually not. We should agree at the annual conference this year in Lima, Peru, on the specific kinds of upfront information that parties should provide so that their undertakings can be readily understood and analyzed. Second, accountability will be enhanced if the upfront information that a party submits along with its mitigation target or actions includes domestic measures such as laws and regulations that support its implementation. Third, the core undertaking itself needs to be unconditional. Many Copenhagen commitments were made conditional on something. It could be conditional on getting money, getting finance. It could be conditional on what some other country does. But a commitment that is entirely conditional is not really a commitment at all. So our view is that a country needs to do something that's unconditional, a core commitment that's unconditional. It can certainly propose to do more, conditioned on something else, but there needs to be a baseline commitment that's unconditional. Fourth, the new agreement should lay out rules or norms and expectations addressing certain substantive aspects of commitments. Sometimes binding rules will work best, sometimes expectations and norms will be more effective, either because the overall group of parties won't be able to agree to a particular rule or because a legally binding rule could have unintended consequences such as actually depressing ambition. The choice here should always be guided by what will be most effective. Fifth, the agreement should provide for regular updating of NDCs at set intervals. As I've said, we like every 5 years. And finally, the new agreement should provide for reporting and review of implementation. People variously refer to this as transparency or MRV or compliance or other terms, but whatever its name, the goal should be to know what parties' emissions are, to know what they're doing in implementing their NDC, and to provide and to promote implementation. And the system needs to be facilitative in character. A punitive system is just not going to get agreed to. Taken together, these pieces would add up to a coherent accountability system that includes mitigation contributions that are real by virtue of upfront information. I'm sorry, clear by virtue of upfront information, real by virtue of being unconditional, and credible by virtue of being buttressed by domestic measures. It would include certain rules, norms, and expectations that put appropriate boundaries around our nationally determined contributions, reporting to make sure our efforts are fully transparent, and review to promote good faith implementation. Now let me turn to adaptation, a key focus of the UNFCCC. For a great many smaller and poorer countries, adaptation is the name of the game. They don't emit much in terms of greenhouse gases, but they're highly vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. And even the most advanced countries need to engage in concerted efforts to build resilience. Anyone who was in the direct flight path of Superstorm Sandy can attest to that, and it's self-evidently true. Stated simply, what countries need with regard to adaptation is better planning and more funding to help implement the plans. Better planning is essential because funding one-off projects will not yield the kind of resilience or adaptive potential that countries at risk need. The new agreement should do two important things in this respect. First, it should call upon countries to integrate climate resilience into their planning processes for development, which few countries actually do. A provision in a new global climate agreement of this kind would give relevant ministers the leverage needed to convince their governments to make adaptation a priority. And this is important to ministers all over the world. Second, the agreement should highlight the importance of all parties completing clear, effective national adaptation plans. Provisions like this could lend momentum to real-world adaptation action and help funders direct adaptation assistance to greatest effect. I should say that the United States is already expanding the ways we help developing countries build their climate resilience. And in fact, this was a central theme of President Obama's speech at the Climate Summit. He announced that we would bring to bear the unique scientific capabilities of the United States to help developing countries by delivering earlier and more accurate outlooks for extreme weather events, as well as powerful data tools to help these countries plan for long-term climatic changes. And with regard to the national adaptation plan process, we intend to further provide support, including through the establishment of a global network to better coordinate these efforts among donor countries. We also need to provide more funding, but this is part of the larger financial assistance issue. So let's turn to that right now. The call for financial support is a perennial part of these negotiations. It is deeply in the interest of the United States and other advanced countries to help poorer countries build resilience against the severe impacts of climate change, which in turn have a very real national security component to them, and also to help these countries organize themselves to build low-carbon economies so that the world collectively can secure the kind of deep reductions that we will need by mid-century. The story on financial assistance has actually been improving strikingly, and it is about to get still better. After a lot of hard work the last few years, the Green Climate Fund, called for in Copenhagen, has a headquarters near Seoul, an executive director, a staff, and even more important, in a matter of weeks, will have a first round of capitalization pledges. Capitalization meeting for the Green Climate Fund happens on November 20th. Moreover, on the subject of adaptation, the board of the Green Climate Fund has already decided that it should allocate money 50-50 between adaptation and mitigation on a grant equivalent basis. That's a big deal, and it will get a lot more money flowing for adaptation than has ever flowed before. The other financial focus for the Paris Agreement is likely to revolve around the commitment made by developed countries in Copenhagen to mobilize $100 billion a year by 2020 from all sources, public and private, in the context of meaningful mitigation and transparency from all countries. The United States, in concert with other donor countries, has been spearheading an effort in the last 2 years to boost the effectiveness of various international channels in mobilizing climate finance to support low-carbon climate-resilient development in poor countries. These include the World Bank and the regional development banks in Asia, Africa, and Latin America, development finance institutions such as our own overseas private investment corporation, OPIC, export credit agencies such as Exim Bank, and all the bilateral assistance programs that provide climate-related aid to poor countries. These channels will continue to operate, so while the Green Climate Fund has the potential to become the preeminent channel of climate finance, it will still be one among many. Much more money is actually flowing now than ever before. Well over $30 billion, probably over $40 billion per year of public funding, not counting the substantial private funds that much of that public funding is able to leverage. For example, every time OPIC provides public funding to do a deal to build a wind or solar or geothermal plant in Africa or Asia or Latin America, it brings in at least one and usually a lot more than $1 from the private sector. We're also pursuing new and innovative approaches to unlock more climate finance through efforts like the Global Innovation Lab for Climate Finance that we and a few other countries launched this year. We launched it with an impressive group of principals and a very encouraging reception as dozens of ideas and proposals were submitted. Those have been narrowed down to 7. They're going to be narrowed down further, I think, to 2 or 3, and then they will start to get road tested. Regarding the new agreement itself, we think it should call upon parties to reaffirm the importance of financial support for countries in need, prioritize the poorest and most vulnerable, especially for adaptation, develop national plans for adaptation and mitigation for low emission development strategies, strengthen the domestic policy environments of recipient countries so that they can attract private investment. This is actually a huge part of the equation. Private investors are only going to go where they think their money is going to be safe and is going to get a return, so you've got to get the so-called enabling environments right in recipient countries. We also need to start phasing out subsidies for fossil fuels, which are estimated at well over $500 billion a year, and only a small part of that goes for poor people. And all countries need to contribute public finance consistent with their real capabilities, and we need to improve reporting both on the provision of finance by donors and the use to which it's put by recipients. Finally, let me turn to the issue of legal form that I alluded to earlier, legal form of the Paris Agreement. The Durban mandate says, in effect, that the new agreement will be a legally binding one in at least some respects, but doesn't specify which respects. We think that the most interesting proposal on the table right now is one that was put forward by New Zealand, under which there would be a legally binding obligation to submit what they call a schedule, but basically your commitment, for reducing emissions, plus various legally binding provisions for accounting, reporting, review, a periodic updating of the schedules, and so forth. But the content of the schedule, of the commitment itself, in the New Zealand proposal would not be legally binding at an international level. We have also suggested that a country might buttress the force of its submission by including a description of the domestic legally binding measures that will be used to help meet the stated goal. Now, some are sure to disapprove the New Zealand idea, some do disapprove the New Zealand idea, since the mitigation commitment itself is not legally binding. But we would counsel against that kind of orthodoxy for several reasons. First, I think many countries, including major ones, will not be willing to make their mitigation commitment legally binding at the international level, and once some balk, the premise of a legal form applicable to all unravels. Second, many countries, if forced to put forward legally binding commitments at the international level, are inevitably going to lowball their commitment out of fear, anxiety about what it means for their commitment to be internationally legally binding. And third, I think if you have the accountability provisions that I talked about at some length legally binding, as they are legally binding in the New Zealand approach, that does most, if not all, of what you need in any event. Allowing others to understand clearly what the mitigation commitment is and to track whether it's being implemented. So let's review the fundamental question. If we were to conclude a new climate agreement in Paris along the lines of what I have just outlined, would we have accomplished much? I think the answer is unequivocally yes. We would have, for the first time, established a stable, durable, rules-based climate agreement with legal force that is more ambitious than ever before, even if not yet ambitious enough, and is built to last, calling for the progressive ramping up of ambition on regular periodic cycles. An agreement that is applicable to all in a genuine, not just formalistic manner, that is fully differentiated so that the interests of countries in developing countries in growth, development, and eradicating poverty are fully protected, is built on a foundation of solid rules-based accountability with strong transparency, reporting, and review, elevates adaptation from both a planning and implementation perspective, encompasses a commitment to large-scale financial and technical assistance, and sends a potent signal to the global community, from boardrooms to governments to civil society, that world leaders have finally put climate change squarely in their sights and are going to keep it there. This would be meaningful indeed. Nothing like it has ever happened before, certainly not Kyoto, which never applied to more than some 27% of global emissions, certainly not Copenhagen and Cancun, which have been important bridges to progress, but did not create the kind of overall system that we're talking about here. This then would be a significant advance that would set us on a long-term path forward. But there are real obstacles, and the most important of these takes us back to that fault line I alluded to earlier in my remarks, the split between developed and developing countries. Common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities, known as CBDR for short, is the core principle asserted by developing countries. It means that we all have common responsibilities in regard to climate change, but that what we actually do must be differentiated based on our own circumstances and capabilities. Developing countries have cared about CBDR so much because the idea of having to limit carbon emissions makes them understandably anxious. Emissions, as I've noted before, come principally from burning fossil fuels to run economies, so action to limit emissions sounds to many countries like a threat to those core imperatives of development, growth, and eradicating poverty. Of course, the whole point of clean energy transformation is to break that link between economic growth and carbon emissions so that vibrant, growing economies can run on while burning little carbon. And we are on the way toward that goal, but we're certainly not there yet. Now, conceptually, we have no problem at all with CBDR and respective capabilities. We see it as an appropriate and enduring principle. Indeed, a key rationale for the NDC structure that we support is that we see it as fully compatible with CBDR. It is a self-differentiated structure in which a country is asked to do its absolute best, but as it sees fit, consistent with its own view of its circumstances and capabilities. The trouble in this area arises because many countries have taken CBDR to mean that those two categories I told you about from 1992, Annex I for developed countries and non-Annex I for developing countries, must never change and must determine the form and content of any new agreement going forward. Our view is that once we have made sure that the material interests, those core imperatives of developing countries, are fully protected, as the NDC structure does, then there is no justification for using fixed 1992 categories to determine who is expected to do what in a new agreement taking effect nearly 30 years after 1992 and intended to define the course of climate diplomacy for decades to come. Such a separation would be inimical to ambition and would undermine the political cohesion we need to build an effective and durable climate system going forward. The original division of countries, after all, was based on material circumstances, not some unchanging feature of national culture or geography. And those material circumstances have changed, sometimes dramatically, in the intervening years, and will, of course, keep changing as the years go forward. Some developing countries argue that changing circumstances are actually irrelevant because the categories are based on history. But, of course, history did not end in 1992. History begins every yesterday. China is not just the largest emitter of greenhouse gases now, it is the second largest historic emitter of greenhouse gases. Nearly every decade now, the world emits more greenhouse gases than all the greenhouse gases emitted in history up till 1970, every decade. A number of non-Annex I countries are at this point among the world's wealthiest, and dozens of them have higher per capita income than the low end of the Annex I scale, and so on and so forth. Of course, those categories would still stay in the underlying 1992 convention, that wouldn't change, but new agreements, including the agreement that we're negotiating now, would not be based in form and content on those categories. Now, I have heard some comments lately saying that self-differentiation is not enough, that there must be something more. But for those who might, particularly those developing countries, who might at first blush agree, I'd ask, what is that more that you have in mind, and what purpose would it serve that is not already served by the self-differentiated NDC structure? The purpose can't be the protection of those core imperatives because, as I've discussed, they're fully protected. To the extent that any are concerned that developed countries will use the bottom-up structure of NDCs to go backwards, to do less than they have done before, the new agreement can and should make clear that all countries are expected to move onward and upward in their ambition, not to fall backwards. To the extent that some feel that there must be a categorical separation in the new agreement because climate change is, after all, the fault of developed countries, that approach is not going to advance the ball because, first of all, developed countries don't accept that worldview, and second, because descending into that kind of debate at this stage in the game is the last way to find common ground. Nor are the 1992 categories necessary to differentiate with respect to other issues apart from the mitigation commitments themselves. On every issue where differentiation is appropriate, there is a way to accomplish it through a single system rather than a bifurcated one. For reporting and review, for example, differentiation could be based on the kind of tiered structure that is already used for reporting on inventories, in which countries self-select into one of three different tiers, from the more simple to the medium to the more sophisticated. Or countries could simply follow a unified set of guidelines but implement those to the greatest extent of their capability. In short, we accept and support differentiation. The NDC structure is fully compatible with CBDR. Every other provision of a new agreement where differentiation is appropriate can be addressed in a manner compatible with CBDR, and concerns about so-called backsliding can be fully addressed. Basing the new agreement and former content on immutable 1990 categories cannot be justified, and insisting on that kind of backwards-facing structure would be a deal breaker. We need to build our new agreement looking forward to reflect the economic, political, and environmental realities of the next decade and beyond. So let me conclude now with a few summary thoughts. First, climate change is an epochal issue that is going to loom large for the generation of students here and that generation worldwide. You have the most to gain if we get this right, and the most to lose if we get it wrong, and the we here includes you. Whether you end up working in areas directly related to clean energy and climate, or in 1,000 unrelated endeavors, be aware of climate change, care about it, and make sure that your leaders do the same. Second, the transformation of the global economy to one based on clean energy is the name of the game. Domestic policy, international negotiations, research, innovation, it all revolves around that. Forests and land use are also crucial, both as intrinsically valuable and for their role in capturing CO2. But our core imperative has to be to break the link between growth and burning fossil fuels. Third, engagement is crucial. It is a basic rule of politics that politicians listen to the voice of potential voters. Maybe not immediately, but before long. When politicians come to believe that not listening could be detrimental to their political health, they will start to listen. Fourth, we have a great opportunity to take a large step forward internationally if we strive to put forward ambitious targets and actions, pursue common ground, and close the deal that is there to be had in Paris. And I think most countries understand fundamentally what that deal is. It won't be everything that anyone wants, but it can be. It should be a historic start, and the time to seize the day is now. The usual brinksmanship of holding cards to the 11th hour is a bad bet because too much is riding on this negotiation. We can't afford to miss the opportunity to establish an ambitious and workable new international climate order. And the UNFCCC, as a credible organization, cannot afford another perceived failure at a pivotal moment. An ambassador colleague of mine from a developing country once told me why he preferred bilateral to multilateral negotiations. In the bilateral context, he said the work was usually pragmatic and practical. You could actually get things done. But in multilateral efforts, he found negotiators often get theological, defending their cherished orthodoxies to the death rather than seeking to find a way forward. We have got to leave theology behind, to recognize the bargain, seize it, and take a big step forward that we won't regret. I think we can do this. I think we will do this. But the clock is ticking. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Todd. I think I speak for all of us in saying thank you in particular for what I think is an unusually clear historical overview of how we got to where we are, where the U.S. would like to see us go, the challenges we need to overcome, and also injecting us with a positive spirit and momentum that we have before us upcoming. At this point, I'd like to welcome Professor Karen Sato up to the stage, who is a professor of geography and urbanization and also the associate dean for research in the School of Forestry and Environmental Studies. She has also served as a leading coordinating author for the most recent IPCC report on in particular, the chapter on mitigation of climate change. And she will be posing questions to Todd Stern based on some of the submissions that we received online.
First of all, I want to welcome all of you who are watching from home or from the office or mobile units. We know that there are many of you who are actually watching online as this is being live streamed. As was mentioned earlier, over the last week, we have had a question box online, and we've gotten a lot of questions from the general public. A lot of these questions came from New Haven, we suspect from many of you in the audience, but we actually had a number of these questions come from far afield, as far as Northeast Connecticut, but also as far as Bangladesh. And so we recognize that there are a number of you who are watching online and probably eager to hear Todd Stern's answers to your questions. What we did was we collated all the questions and we organized them by theme, and there are a number of very common themes that emerged from many of the questions. We don't want to keep Todd too long, but hopefully we'll get through a number of these questions. What I'd like to do is start off with towards the end of your comments, you were talking about common but differentiated responsibility, and there were a number of questions about this point. Many would argue that the focus on common but differentiated responsibility has led to paralysis and a lot of finger-pointing within the UNFCCC. Is it time to shift our focus away from this concept of CBDR to something else that might be more effective while somehow recognizing the concerns of both developing and developed countries?
Thank you very much, and thanks to all the people who submitted questions. CBDR is an absolutely core central principle for developing countries. So I don't actually think that there's an option. There's certainly not an option for us to shift away from it. I think what is important and what I tried to elaborate in my comments is that the real issue, the real issue is how you interpret that clause, which didn't come with exegesis in the 1992 convention. It just had those words. And really fundamentally, you can interpret those, if you interpret those words in a very straightforward, common sense way, they're not problematic. The problem has been, as I say, the effort to keep the agreement completely bifurcated. And this is, you know, I wouldn't have talked as long about it as I did if it weren't a completely live debate right now. And so developing countries feel a certain safety in having everything in the agreement say this is what Annex 1 does and this is what non-Annex 1 does, and we shall never be that. But it doesn't make sense it's not tenable, really, either substantively, for the reasons that I was already alluding to about changing circumstances and the emissions that are coming now from developing countries. And it's not viable politically either, because you won't get support in the United States or in other countries for a system that that puts countries that are puts China and Lesotho in the same category and says they both do the same thing because they're in the same category. That doesn't work. But I don't think you can wave a wand and say, let's get rid of this issue, because it's a very important issue for developing countries.
So something else you raised in your remarks is the categorization of Annex I and non-Annex I countries, and that when those categories were established, the world was a very different place, and a lot of the countries that were developing are now either emerging or they're fully developed, and that we're actually in a very different place today. In fact, today, China is the largest emitter of greenhouse gas emissions, and both the United States and China are the largest emitters. And they will both play a really critical role in achieving a successful international agreement. Could you say something about how the U.S.-China relationship has evolved over recent years on this issue and how it might impact the outcome of successful multilateral negotiations? And also, if you could also speak a little bit about India as well.
Sure, I'd be happy to. So we have been working very closely and very intensively with the Chinese. We have a very good, I think, cooperative relationship with them. I have spent more hours with my counterpart Xie Zhenhua, whom I'm very fond of, than I can count. Going back to 2009, we're a couple of the only old dogs left in this negotiation who haven't been swapped out by their by their governments, but. And I think that we, you know, when I went with Secretary Kerry to China in February, well, first of all, last year, we agreed to a new vehicle called the U.S.-China Climate Change Working Group, and initiated five new initiatives in different areas of essentially clean energy, that we're working on a bilateral basis quite intensively on with China. We talk about the international negotiations all the time as well. In February of this year, I went with Secretary Kerry again, and we agreed with the Chinese and put out a little statement to this effect that we would collaborate on the development of our post-2020 goals, essentially. I think it was our post-2020 plans to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but essentially on our post-2020 targets. And we have been trying to carry out that agreement in February. There is an annual interagency meeting that happens between the U.S. and the Chinese every summer called the Strategic and Economic Dialogue. It goes back and forth between China and the U.S. This year was in China. And I went along with my close colleague and I must say extremely important player in the U.S. government on these issues, John Podesta, a day early, and spent the entire day, you know, with a team of people behind us, meeting with the Chinese and their teams to talk about what our policies were, what we had accomplished so far, what we were thinking about doing, what they're thinking about doing, how we see our trajectory and their trajectory. You know, just a lot of very detailed back and forth. We're continuing to have conversations with them. We had good meetings in New York on the on the margins of the UN General Assembly discussions. So I can't tell you this is exactly what's going to come out of that, but it is a cordial and quite active interaction, and I am hopeful that we have good movement over time. It remains to be seen, but we are certainly working that hard. India has had an enormously consequential new election, the biggest Democratic election in history by a lot. Prime Minister Modi is in place now. He's a quite impressive and strong figure. He has some background on in clean energy. Clean energy, of course, is just the solution side of climate change, is the way I look at it. And he was the leader of Gujarat province in India, one of the big provinces, and had a tremendously good record in promoting solar energy and other kinds of developments. And I mentioned one of the goals that he has articulated during my speech. So we're hopeful about India. I can't say that we have seen any change in their negotiating position yet, but you know, they haven't been in for long. They're still putting leadership of their ministries in and new people being brought in, and even new kind of entities being created within the Indian government. So I am, you know, I'm hopeful that we will have a good partner in India. We've worked closely with India over the years. They have kind of waxed and waned in terms of their of the policy positions that they have espoused, but I'm hopeful about India.
Great, thank you. Some people would argue that domestic policies in the United States to reduce greenhouse gas emissions only make sense if other countries adopt very similar types of policies. How have recent actions to implement President Obama's climate action plan impacted the role of the U.S. role in international negotiations?
I think that they have impacted it a lot. You can't ever forget the degree to which countries around the world in an international negotiation look to us. They look to us if they're mad at us, they look to us if they're pleased with us, they just look to us. I mean, it's just a fact of life. Countries in the climate sphere were very unhappy with the United States for a long time, and we're not going to debate whether that's justified or unjustified, but and I think that there were real, very profound flaws in the Kyoto Protocol. And I was one of the people in Kyoto working on it, but I think there were real flaws. But suffice it to say, when President Bush, to say it just in layman's terms, effectively pulled the U.S. out, it's not exactly what happened, but that's the effect of it, countries became very unhappy, other countries, and you know, and really the U.S. wasn't a significant player in negotiations from 2001 through 2008. And so the U.S. came in with a, you know, with quite a bad image. When we came in the Obama administration in 2009, and I came in to work at State at Secretary Clinton's request, I went to a meeting that ordinarily I wouldn't go to. The way these things work is there are three or four big meetings of 190 countries, but at the so-called negotiator level. So that's like a one notch below me, and then I'm at the so-called ministerial level. But I went to that first negotiator meeting because I wanted to signal that the United States, it was a new day in the United States. And I walked in and I made comments and I got a large scale, at least partially standing ovation. And I said to the person next to me, appreciate it, because that's the last one I'm going to get. and that was true. But when countries look to see what the president and the administration has done with respect to the climate action plan and the large-scale action that's being taken, the power plant sector is a third of our emissions. Transportation is a third of our emissions. Major actions taken in both of those areas, really major actions. Buildings is another large part of our total emissions, and we have the most ambitious set of essentially building standards for the appliances that make buildings work than we've ever had before. And renewable energy has doubled in the first term under President Obama, and he has pledged to double it again by 2020. So there's just all sorts of action, and people can see it, and people hear the inaugural address, and they hear the State of the Union, and they hear the Georgetown speech, and they hear the many other remarks that the president has made, and the steady drumbeat of not just actions, but of opportunities for public engagement that has gone on in the White House with, as I said before, with John Podesta driving the whole thing, and it just makes a big difference. It gives us a level of credibility, and it gives us a level of leverage that that we have not had in the time I've been here.
So speaking of public engagement and action, I want to shift the focus to the action that took place recently on the streets of New York City. Many people here, many of our students and faculty participated in the climate march in New York City during the UN General Assembly. How do you think such citizen activism affects the chances of government showing more leadership to meaningfully address climate change?
Well, I actually think that the march was the most important thing that happened that week. You had 400,000 people in the streets of New York, way more than had ever showed up for any climate demonstration in the past. It doesn't have a direct, immediate, there was a march and now this is going to happen type of effect, but it demonstrates a level of engagement and political will that that's powerful, and that needs to be continued to be addressed and to be demonstrated in many different ways as we go forward. I made a few comments about the need for engagement towards the end, but I totally believe that. I mean, we have a situation right now where you have a full throttle administration doing everything they can on the basis of existing authority, right? The Clean Air Act or other existing pieces of legislation. That's great, and I think that the president and his team, we're squeezing every ounce we can out of that authority, but you can't go far enough unless you can also get new legislative action, and Congress is gridlocked on these things right now. It's going to be very important for members of Congress over time. It's not going to happen in a day or a week, it's not going to happen in one march, but people have got to see that the public demands action and that there's a cost in not taking action.
Okay, so my final question is going to shift focus to the university. So many universities around the world are engaged in research related to a number of different dimensions of climate change, and often, whether it's faculty or their research directly, trying to also influence the policy making and negotiations directly. What advice do you have for academic institutions like ours seeking to have a positive impact on climate change policy? What's the role of universities?
Well, I think that universities have an important role in a variety of ways. First of all, as I think you saw even from the remarks that I gave, there are many quite different aspects of climate change. The straight physical natural science is enormously important. I mean, we're acting because of the understanding that we have from scientists. So, and we know a lot. I mean, those who suggest that we don't know enough to take action now are clearly not right. But there's an enormous amount that we don't know. I mean, this is an area for ongoing research that in effect drives policy, not in a one-to-one way, but it's the underpinning of policy. So the straight natural science side of this is hugely important. The economic side of this is hugely important. Again, climate change is really not an environmental issue. It's also an environmental issue, but it's about the running of economies. And so if we propose to take X, Y, or Z action, what's the effect going to be? How much is it going to cost? When is it? Are we thinking about cost in the right way? Are you thinking about cost not just in the upfront cost that you've got to pay to do the solar or wind thing rather than the coal thing? In what way are you taking into account the large-scale costs that are going to come from on the health side, from people getting sick from coal pollution? Are you thinking about cost? Is there a way to internalize cost? Well, there's obviously one way to internalize cost. That's with a carbon price. But there's also there's a social cost of carbon, which is one step removed from that, but still important. So there's an economic dimension that is absolutely pivotal and is going to continue to be pivotal in every way going forward. There's obviously the side of thinking about specific policy mechanisms that might get proposed either in the domestic side, in whatever sector of the economy, or ideas that are relevant in thinking about international action. And those ideas, by the way, could have to do with the negotiations, but they don't have to do with the negotiations. I mean, I didn't talk about several activities that we are engaged in internationally that are what you might call plurilateral. They're not multilateral, they're not part of the negotiations, but we've done a number of things. The Climate and Clean Air Coalition is something that we started with five other countries. There's now over 40 countries and over 40 non-country participants, all working to reduce non-CO2 pollutants, which are also quite potent. There are, your famous economic professor Nordhaus has recently been talking about a completely different sort of idea for action internationally. I'm not commenting on whether that's feasible or not, but there's all sorts of ways to think about how to move the ball forward. This is a long-term challenge. We're not going to fix this in a day. If we get the agreement that I want, that's great, but that's not going to fix it either. That's going to be a step forward. So universities, Yale is a preeminent one among them, have an intellectual foundation and a breadth of a kind of interdisciplinary breadth that is hugely valuable, and people in government chasing after the next thing that is coming at them, chasing it or just dealing with the next thing that's coming at them at high speed day after day, are usually not going to think the deep thoughts. You know, we try to take in, and I do this. I do this not infrequently, try to get input from universities, from think tanks, and others, people who have a little bit more luxury to think things through. So I think a very important role, and by the way, also an important role, I think, as a university internationally. There's more and more action by places like Yale and a few other major ones, I won't mention the others, that are interacting with other countries, with other universities in other countries, and that's going to be important too, because we are just on the front end of this economic transformation that we need to go through.
Okay, so we've only scratched the surface of the questions that got sent in, but I think it's time for us to probably end this evening. And please join me in thanking Todd Stern for sharing his thoughts. Okay, thank you very much.